Our first guest is one of the founding fathers of hip-hop, and for nearly 40 years, 40 years.
Can you believe it?
Yes, he's remained not only relevant, but one of the most important forces in music.
Here to discuss his illustrious career, the birth of hip hop, and the future of the genre is legendary rapper and record producer Kurtis Blow. Welcome to Arise 360.
Wow, thank you. Thank you for having me here.
We are not worthy. We are not worthy. We are not worthy.
Thanks.
So hip hop is celebrating its 40th anniversary. When you were planting the seeds back then, did you have any idea that it would sprout into this musical oak tree?
Oh, well, you know, we were all just trying to have fun and entertain people and just stay away from crime and all the bad things that were in the ghetto. And we had no idea it was going to spread like this. I knew that it had the potential of spreading around the five boroughs, and that's what we were concerned about. And once it did that, it was like, wow, sky's the limit.
It went a lot further than New York because you were the first rap artist to find commercial success. You were the first one to sign a major record deal, the first to release a gold record, the first to embark on an international tour, and the first with endorsement deals. Wow. Now, why do you think mainstream just embraced you so much?
I think it was because, well, I was with a major label, so that was a big part of it. You know, we had major offices in every major city around the world. So I was doing the promo work, and I learned at an early age, you know, to work within the system, in the mainstream, and each different department. I knew the heads and the secretaries and everybody, and I worked the system. So I was very, very much into going to do promo work. So I was the first to go to Europe, and when I got out to, say, places like Paris and Belgium and London and, you know, Japan and stuff like that, I would go to the office of my record company, and they would have in the conference room interview after interview set up throughout the day, and I was doing the promo tour. Well,
what did those international fans think of you? Because you were the first, you know, exposure to hip-hop that they were hearing.
Well, it was like, it was fresh and new and really exciting and mystical all to them, and they wanted to find out, what is this thing hip-hop? And it was, you know, I had been doing it for about 7 to 8 years before I actually got the record deal, so, you know, it was easy for me to just represent, and so much fun. I think we all were blessed and, you know, just blessed by God to be in the right place at the right time to make that happen.
It's so interesting because there was a time when hip-hop was regarded as suspect, scary, and now it's not just hip-hop culture, it is mainstream culture.
Yeah.
What was that period like when rappers were regarded as outlaws?
Well, you know, back in the days when we first started, we were looked at not as outlaws, but more something like street kids with a heart, with integrity. And we had a code of ethics. Like, back then, you know, we didn't curse on the microphone. We didn't curse in our music. Profanity was taboo. And you know, we used to have this little saying, like, I got style and I got class and I don't talk my stuff too fast.
I like that. It's evolved definitely since then.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, people looked at us like, oh, it's just a fad. It's not going to be around. Oh, it's not real music. But, you know, we got out there and we were blessed by having talent. So the talent shined through. And you know, look at us now.
Yeah.
40 years.
Well, we've got to talk about the breaks.
Yes, please. Okay.
Sold more than 500,000 copies.
Yes.
Became an instant classic. Did you have any idea that that would become not only one of the biggest songs of your career, but one of the most important songs in hip hop history?
Well, it was like, wow. I say my life is like a dream world and a bunch of miracles, a series of miracles, and the breaks, that song definitely was my calling card. You know, it's the first certified gold rap song ever. Mm-hmm. And not only that, it was the second certified gold 12-inch song in the history of music.
Really?
And the first certified gold was Barbra Streisand and Donna Summer's Enough is Enough, song.
Well, I'm feeling a little nostalgic at this moment. Can we take a look back from one of your greatest performances on Soul Train?
Soul Train.
Okay. I just clap your hands, everybody. If you got what it takes, Cause I'm Kurtis Blow, and I want you to know that these are the Braids.
Was this your first time performing on national television?
That was the first time ever hip hop was on national television. Okay, I was 20 years old.
How did you feel? What was going through your mind at the time?
Oh, I was nervous. I was scared to death.
No way. You couldn't tell.
You looked really confident.
Actually, I had a little thing with Don Cornelius because Soul Train, I don't know if you know, but every time an artist would go on Soul Train, you had to lip sync. That was the policy.
Really?
I wasn't having that. I wanted to sing live. That was my thing. You know, I'm a rapper. You know, let me sing. Put on instrumental. Let's go.
Let's go.
So we had a big argument about that. But finally, they gave me the mic and let me sing that. So that's the first time you ever saw someone sing live on Soul Train.
Wow. Now, a lot of people are familiar.
A lot of firsts in your life.
Right. Yeah.
First everything.
Now, a lot of people are familiar with the breaks, but a lot of people don't know that your first song was actually a Christmas rap.
Yes.
Why a Christmas song?
Well, that was an idea by my producer, J.B. Moore, and his partner, Robert Ford. They thought that if we did a Christmas song, that we could get on the radio and it would be an annual classic and play every Christmas. So that was definitely his idea. I didn't know what the hell he was talking about. But we did it, and it turned into a classic, and my first song, my favorite, because it's my first, it's my baby, and it's still going on. Still to this day, I got to thank radio and all the people on the radio who play records and who have played that song throughout the years. Thank you for the support. Thank you for making that an annual classic like Nat King Cole.
Let's talk about another one of your classics, If I Ruled the World.
Wow.
Thank you.
That was from the movie Crush Groove.
We are going to talk about that too.
I had a ball doing that. I was doing a lot of work. I was producing my album. I was producing the soundtrack for Crush Groove and also the Fat Boys album. I was producing there. So I was producing three albums at one time and then had to show up on the set at 6 a.m. in the morning every morning for 3 weeks. And man, we had three studios going. I was a hot piece of work.
Wow.
And you know,
you were the Pharrell of your day.
I know, right? He did not stop working,
didn't
sleep. And a lot of people actually sampled that song, If I Ruled the World, like Nas on one of his albums.
Yes.
How does it feel to hear your music reinterpreted by other artists?
Oh, that's great. It's honor, straight, you know, just the epitome of just a compliment when an artist samples and redoes your song. And big shout out to Nas and the whole crew, and also Too Close with the group Next. I gotta shout them out. Mm-hmm. Bow Wow, people like that. Romeo, who did the basketball song over. It's a great thing, straight honor. And it also, you know, it gives a classic longer legs and longer life.
It's true. A whole new generation gets to discover your music.
Yes.
Let's talk about Crush Groove. You mentioned it earlier, 1985. I mean, you're on set with Fat Boys, LL Cool J. I mean, the list goes on. Run DMC, Rick Rubin. The list goes on and on. What was it like to film that movie? And did you know it would become an instant hip-hop classic?
Well, it was fun. It was really fun because, you know, it was my first movie. So I'm just having the ball of my life, the joy of my life right there. Like I said, you know, one miracle after another, and that was another one. Just being on the set, you know, when Sheila E. is doing her part, and then we hear in the background, Prince is upstairs in the balcony checking you guys out in secret location.
You're kidding.
We're like, wow, Prince is here, you know. Wow. So we had a lot of people show up, and just, I mean, I can't imagine, I can't even explain what happened at the premiere at Studio 54.
What happened?
They shut the block down, and 5,000 people out there on 54th Street, and it was just an incredible party that night. That was the top of the world. Top of the world, Ma.
Well, what was the energy like on set? Did you guys, like, have rhyme battles when the cameras were off?
You know what? You know, we were actually, you know, really, we were rookies as actors and actresses. So Gloria Schultz, who was Michael Schultz's wife, Michael Schultz was the director.
Okay.
He did many, many incredible, incredible famous movies. Michael Schultz, and his wife was our script coach. Mm.
Oh,
so she literally taught us how to act in this movie.
So you didn't have any time to play around?
No.
Focus.
We were studying. We were studying those lyrics, those lines.
Had to hit your marks, hit the lighting right, remember your script.
All new, and we wanted to do, you know, we didn't want Gloria Schultz to get on us.
No,
she was a tough lady, yes.
Well, you all went on to become international superstars. Do you keep in touch with one another?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. I talked to Russell just the other day. He sent me a great letter up in the Bronx. We're doing an anniversary party and stuff, and I talked to Run, I talked to the Fat Boys still. I'm on Twitter, so Sheila E. Tweeted me the other day.
She did not.
Yes, she's a born-again Christian.
What'd she tweet you?
She's a born-again Christian.
Sheila E.'s a born-again Christian?
She just said, hello, Kurtis Blow, God bless you, and, you know. Yeah, so I hear from people from time to time. We all love each other. The love will never leave, and it's just, you know, incredible how after all these years, if I would see any one of them, it would be like it was just during that time of Crush Group or back in those days.
Wow.
We would miss a beat, yeah.
We should do a reunion movie.
Yeah.
Really, right? A Crush Group too.
Hey, we would watch it.
Yeah, we would.
Where'd all turn out. All right. Well, we don't want you to go anywhere because we have a lot more to come with you and a live performance. We can't wait. Don't go anywhere. Arise Entertainment 360. We'll be right back.